be first.
Yes, sir. I'll tell you, when we were given the challenge of, okay, what happens if you put the roads and the water and sewer and the zoning and planning and permitting improvements, et cetera, on one map, do you see any gaps? And we saw one particular gap in general. But ultimately, one of the first things that we found is we wanted some sense of where have we been growing. And so what we looked at was a piece of information the tax assessors keep track of called year built. It's not permits, it's where have you built a house? Where have you built a house in the last 5 years? What we found was both remarkable and alarming. If you've not seen this slide yet, what this shows you is year built information. So these are new residential construction information between the county, the city of Valdosta, Hayhira, and Lake Park. And what you're going to discover is this matches up fairly well with the road investments, with the water and sewer investments. And that's the part that you and staff should feel very good about, that we are investing in infrastructure in the areas where it is growing and where we're seeing high amounts of growth. We are either with the market or complementing that market very well. The remarkable part is when you look at it by numbers and you back out city limits, this is what really got our attention. So in the last 5 years, the unincorporated area has done 1,319 new builds. Hayhira has done 68, Lake Park has done 17, and Valdosta has done 189. So the remarkable part is that we've done 1,045 more residential houses than either one of those cities. We did not expect, when we were given this challenge by Mr. Christian, for those numbers to be as high as they are. But that's what they are. So the remarkable part is we are doing some things that the market is complimenting us on, and we are being complimented by that same market. So that's something that we should have a good feeling about. The alarming part and the flip side of that is, as a county, we not only have to look out for the unincorporated area, we have to look out for the entire county. And when you pull these numbers into an entire county health standpoint, for the city of Valdosta to be growing at 10% of what the county is growing at, especially residentially, that's not good. And that's not a good trend for them, and that's something that as the county, while we are growing, long term, it is not good for the city of Valdosta to not be growing near the amount residentially as we are. And that's a trend for us that is both remarkable and alarming. And so that to me is the most telling part of this slide, is when we all as staff began to look at this, we were not prepared for such a discrepancy over the last 5 years between those various jurisdictions. Now, to be fair to the city, these numbers don't include apartments. Their apartment numbers certainly have broached ours as far as developing a more multifamily. The city does not include numbers that relate to a significant housing improvement. I have an existing house, but I just completely remodel it. So those numbers aren't there. But certainly when you look at new residential construction, that was something to us that was a major factor in sticking out between how the unincorporated area county is growing in relation to what's happening inside the cities. Not as concerned about Hayhira and Lake Park as much, because they're smaller cities, they're growing just fine. There's some sewer concerns in Hayhira for allowing them to grow in the future, but certainly between Valdosta and the unincorporated area, those are significant differences in the growth pattern for residential houses.
I think we all anticipated that there would be significant growth in the unincorporated area, but certainly not to the degree that Jason has described. When he brought this back to us for review, it was shocking from the standpoint. We just sat there and looked at this for a few minutes to say, Jason, are you sure you made this right?
We went back to the assessors to just, are we sure that the data is good? Did we look at this wrong? I mean, we tested it because we thought that's not right. You know, that can't be right.
It's too much of a difference.
That's right, but it tested out with them. So even the people who keep track of it, that is something significant, and it's remarkable but alarming. Remarkable because of the county's standpoint. Alarming because from the standpoint of the city and keeping the city healthy, because we want them certainly to be a healthy city in the county.
Residential units in the unincorporated areas versus residential units in Valdosta, what percentage of growth I mean, are they comparable units now, or were they comparable units 5 years ago?
As far as population?
Or just the total housing units, just the total, I guess, residential housings.
We could find that, but our populations are comparable. We could try to find specific household numbers for unincorporated versus Valdosta.
I just wonder, because you're going to have a greater population that live in apartments inside the city limits. Seeing though the population may be the same, you may have less housing units inside the city of Austin versus the incorporated areas, which it shouldn't be that big a difference, but is Valdosta's housing market growing at 1%, that we're growing at 10%, or, you know, is it closer percentage-wise, even though it may be a bigger number here? I just don't know. I'd like to see that.
We can pull those numbers so you can see the breakdown of the different types of housing, but it won't cover.
Just seeing those numbers, I don't think it would, but it may not be as drastic as percentage-wise as those numbers are showing.
Right.
And just to piggyback on Jason, almost right at 1,200 of those lots in the county were lots that are in newly platted subdivisions. I mean, because our office, part of our requirements group, the NPDS, is every new lot built inside of a subdivision, we put our eyes on.
Yep.
And so we did, in the last 5 years, we did a little over 1,200 new residential inspections. So most of those 1,300 are in newly platted subdivisions.
I mean, the numbers were consistent. If we went back to how many lots have you created, how many permits have you pulled, we expected that, but we just didn't expect a gap.
Before the next slide of incorporating in, road improvements into this, Jason, what do you and Carmella think as we're getting closer to our comp plan, and with this growth and this development as we see now, do you see some significant or suggestions as how we develop any changes for our zoning, any changes for our land use?
And we have. I mean, we, based on one gap in particular, we have some slides prepared after this to kind of highlight that area, sir. We do. We know of at least one gap that we're aware of.
And just to piggyback with Jason, it's just that comp plan and that future development map. It's a living document, and we need to just constantly, you know, look at that. Because sometimes we, even with staff, we have, you know, differences in opinion on what the map has to say and what the actuality of the matter is.
But we do. We highlighted the area that we think is probably the biggest one to consider. We have slides on that just a minute.
Well, I think that the numbers, Jason, as you said, I mean, they speak for themselves. Mm-hmm. They tell you really where those trends are. And I think then, as we probably will see as we move through this process, again, the importance and the responsibility that we as county government has to make sure that those areas where it's trending, that we're going to be able to provide the services that those individuals in those areas are going to be requiring. Because, I mean, it's fairly apparent that there's beginning to be some concentration of density areas. And so certainly those areas are going to have to be addressed as we move forward and make sure that we can provide those services.
Yes, sir. I mean, we, you know, and Mike and Steven, Mel and I, we know this, but I mean, 20 years ago, the primary growth corridor was Bemis, and then we started to open up North Valdosta. Last 10 years, it's primarily been North Valdosta, and you can see pockets at different places, obviously with Kinderloop Forest, or when we reactivated, they had that big auction for Lake Alapaha, how that has opened up. But, you know, around the interstate exits, coincidentally, not really where we have water and sewer infrastructure, you're seeing some growth. Part of that response is the fact that if you don't have water and sewer, you're stuck at about an acre of land. If you have an acre of land, the house you're putting on an acre of land prices you out of the market. There's only so many people in Lowndes County who can afford a house on 1 acre of land. So what you have to do is you either have to put your own water system in to get to a half acre, or try to find county water sewer, which gets your land cost to where you actually can have a more affordable house. Because if you get that acre of land, it's going to be a super nice house, great looking piece of property, but it's going to be $250,000 plus, and there's just only so many people that it can afford to buy that home. So you're seeing growth around where that water and sewer and those paved roads are, because Mike is right. I mean, if the market's getting so tight, for example, on Clydestone, in order to make the water sewer numbers work, they don't have enough money to float the paving of the road. So there's just people waiting to have that area grow because they realize, I can't make it work yet. Because they know they want to account for the land, but they also have to account for that house price. And they don't want to go in there and start marketing $200,000 houses because, honestly, before the recession hit, that's where everybody went to, because you sell one or two houses a year and you're doing fine. Well, not everybody can afford a 189, 199, 210 level of house.
And we have some local demographics on our local economy to talk about tomorrow that will show where we are as a community from price point standpoint.
And so this next slide was just a consolidation of the permit numbers and where some of our new potential new paved roads are going to be, and you can see those are really spread out between commission districts, but they do reflect consistency, like what Mike said. The improvements are happening where people are using our roads, not only paved but unpaved. So this is just another slide. This basically uses where have you seen some of the unincorporated area commercial growth. Again, you can see Bemis, North Valdosta, around the Lake Park area, but ultimately, nothing surprising. We haven't got to a point where we've got the city's infrastructure or city's permits yet. We don't feel like we have good apples-to-apples comparison yet, but ultimately, just an idea about where that non-residential improvement is going.
I think your trend will show you when you get the city's numbers is that their commercial development is their bright spot.
It is.
I mean, that's where their development is at. But again, it's also important that we, in our trends and in our zoning and planning, that we also consider around these concentrated density areas that there is some commercial development that's there in order to support that.
Yep. I mean, I agree with you. Their numbers I expect them to be higher than ours. Mm-hmm. I don't expect the gap to be as drastic as what we found for residential, but we certainly are housing the people that support their commercial markets. Okay, so moving on, as we get into, this is just a copy of the overall kind of current county character area map, otherwise future land use map. As a part of these improvements, we're just going to focus in on, okay, based on roads, water and sewer, planning and zoning, where are things consistent and where are things not consistent? And honestly, we only found one area where we really felt like in the short term there needed to be some address. We needed to address some inconsistencies. So if we'll go to the next slide, please, sir. The waterline extension. So north part of the county, some of the land that Mike mentioned, rightly so, for NATCO, this huge acreage here, it's almost, you know, it's multiple pieces, but it's all one owner. That's NATCO. So this land is all tied up into that 50-year lease, which is about to come up. With us putting a water line, there's our existing sewer force main right there, and we're putting a water line right through here. When the decision was made originally to go through Sermons Road, is it lane or is it road? Sermons Lane. So the original idea was we're going to take this water line to here, bring it down to Sermons, and bring it up. From a planning and zoning standpoint, that water line equals growth, because now instead of having an acre lot, you can do at least a half an acre. Because you can do a half acre on water, on community water or county water and septic tank, which is what we expect people to pursue. Well, when the decision was made to move this water line here to save on the construction costs, and now we went from Sermons Lane to Lucas Richardson Road, we impacted two areas. So we expected an impact here. And this area, this lower red area, is about 440 acres, and we basically shifted our growth about half a mile, about 0.4 miles north. When we went further north to Lucas Richardson, we shifted it about 0.7 miles further north, and this area that is going to be impacted is probably about 740 acres. So when we made this shift, the one we were expecting and the one we just realized was a better idea from a water construction standpoint, you're impacting about a square mile of property, a little over 1,100 acres, and ultimately, I'm sorry, it's about 1.8 square miles, but you moved our growth about 1.1 miles to the north. Well, what does that mean? Well, the next slide is our future land use map. And typically, this is what Carmel and I get most of our questions on for future growth. So right now, this is rural residential. So before these shifts, we could have expected rezoning cases that probably were maybe in the 1 acre range. Hard to get, more expensive market, probably not as common. So right now, this orange color meant we could have expected some 1 acre rezonings. If you shift these north, it's going to probably realistically look like this peach color, which is all we all know is suburban area. And you can see all the growth we've experienced to the south is dominantly in that suburban area. And what that does, sir, if you will not change it, is if you change those to suburban area, this is our zoning map, what you've now done is instead of having 1 acre requests here and here, you've pushed 1 acre out to here. You've pushed it further north, and now what you're going to get in here is R21, half acre, R10, potentially even PD if they run water and sewer here or here. So what you've done is you've taken this, you know, 1.8 square miles of property, and you've really opened it up to where our plans, like Carmela said, it's just not, it hasn't lived that much yet. It hasn't lived out this area yet. So our plans are behind that waterline construction. And so, Jason, what are you saying? I'm saying expect rezoning cases for these areas. These are larger property. It dovetails, this very end is the tail of the NACCO property that goes all the way over here. But when you put that water and sewer in the ground, especially the water line, sewer's all the way up here at Nelson Hill, so it's not far away. But certainly when you put that water line in the ground here, you've just taken this growth pattern, which was kind of capped at Nelson Hill, and you've moved it about a mile north, which means this kind of 1 acre growth pattern that was here is now going to shift towards McMillan and north. So those are the most significant impacts that we found where we feel like there's a place for our plans to catch up with our investment in our infrastructure, and that's the area that we see opening up very shortly as soon as those water lines are live, because for developers it means it's something that's going to be more attractive to them.
Like Steve was saying, it's less expensive to put sewer in the ground than it is water, and if you take that big ticket item off of there with the water. And now that really the only infrastructure they have to run is sewer, that R10 looks a lot prettier to the developers, that having water and sewer.
The adjustment that will need to be made to the ULDC, will that need come, as you're saying, after the water and sewer project is completed, and then you would open that up?
There's two documents you're really talking about. One is the comp plan. Well, that can happen at any time. The comp plan is recommending, but of course you want the comp plan to reflect what we think the growth is going to be. So that's something that can be brought to the commission. The ULDC, I don't see any changes that will need to reflect here. It's just that's where those rezoning requests come in. One thing the commission could consider is potentially, you know, trying to rezone a property ahead of that market, and I know that's on the table, but it's not something that I've seen commissioners in the year past typically do. They let the market drive where those cases are going to be. So while we do need to address the comp plan, we just expect those rezonings right now, my money is on, you know, as they come in from various developers, they'll just come to the commission's agenda, and we'll have to go through those kind of piece by piece. The kicker here is, there's a lot of big pieces. I mean, it's an attractive area. There's not a, you know, you can see here on, this is kind of family land off of Sermons. There's some family land off the south side of Lucas Richardson, but there's a lot of big chunks of property. It's not a lot of smaller developed family land. It's a lot of big chunks. So I think that'll come into place in two forms, a comp plan update that's just on our own initiative when we feel like it's time, and then individual rezoning cases on your agenda that probably without that waterline extension, they wouldn't be there. I don't think they'd be there. So this is a rough map. I mean, Carmel, before I move on, anything you want to add, ma'am, on the zoning part? I mean, I just know for us, we see that and we're like, I mean, get ready. It's kind of where we're at, is just get ready. So this one right here, the last two slides that we have, there's a piece of information that the tax assessors keep track of for every single piece of property in the county called dig class. And what it really translates to is every single piece of property in the county has a tax use charge. So this light green is forestry. Lighter green is ag, darker green is conservation, yellow is residential, red is commercial, black is exempt. So these classifications matter because they give you some hint about how valuable that property, what kind of value that property is being taxed at. So this is what that information looked like in 2013. And you've got some numbers, it's harder to see on the screen, but they're in your book. We wanted to show you kind of how have those classifications changed over 5 years. Because one of the things Mr. Pritchard talks about in our department head meetings is he'll sit there and he'll look at us and he'll say, guys, our financial numbers are flat. You know, keep things tight. And then, you know, some of us, Carmel and myself and Steve and Mike and probably even Robin, look at it like, there's no way. We are so busy. How can our numbers be flat? That is wrong. I don't know where you're getting that from.
So don't tell me that.
Yeah, I know. I'm just thinking. I'm like, there's no way. So if you go to the next slide, this gives you a clue about why, even though our growth is strong, our numbers aren't as strong. And the clue is, when you look at this map compared to 2013, one of the things you're going to notice is the growth in this light green category, which is forestry, and the growth in this dark green category, which is conservation. Why that's important and significant is because those categories are taxed lower than the light green ag category. So as you transition away from ag to conservation or forestry, you're losing your tax base. Your tax base is changing in a way that doesn't help your value. So while your residential is getting more valuable and more valuable, it's being offset by your ag getting less valuable. For example, if you compare the numbers between 2013 and 2018 for ag, so agricultural has lost 20,717 acres. 5 years. And it's even more if you go back to 2007. So we lost 20,000 acres of ag. And where it went is 10,000 of it went to forest and 10,000 went to conservation. So residential, for example, haven't we grown residentially? Haven't we grown? We just proved we certainly have grown residentially. Residential acreage has lost 1,500 acres. Well, how can that be if you're growing? Because people who are classified as residential went to a different category. And so as a part of that, we lift that up because that kind of trend is a clue about why we have to make peace with the fact that Mr. Pritchard tells us, guys, I know you're growing, but the numbers aren't there yet. We think this is at least a clue about why, if you look back to the last 10, 15 years, certainly this 5 years, more people in the unincorporated area are switching their classification to a tax class that is less valuable, which means less revenue, even though it's being buoyed by our residential and commercial growth. So that's why I think we see some growth, but not near what you would expect if these two factors weren't working against each other.
I think you get that, Jason. You also have the fact that we looked at earlier that inside of the incorporated areas, the values are going down. So and we got to look at it as a whole because that's part of our taxes and income from the incorporated areas as well.
That's right.
If there's values are going down, then any growth we've got in the county is going to be offset.
Again, it goes back to the whole revenue question is why is it either, as Mr. Pritchard likes to preach, that it's flat, then why is that? Well, it's not one specific thing
right. That
we feel like that you might could target and say, let's see if we can fix this. It's a multitude of issues that's causing it to be the way it is, whether it's TABT, whether it's reclassification of land, whether it's valuations, or whatever the case may be. It's a number of things.
It is, and to me there are, you know, that number of things has easier ones and harder ones. You know, I mean, one of the easier ones is the housing stock in the city of Valdosta is getting older, and people would rather invest in a new house than buy an existing house. But yes, sir, there's a list there, both easy and hard reasons. And then, pending any thoughts from Carmilla, I think that's all we had.
comments, any questions? Y'all see,
wow.
Yeah, y'all see that when we began to look at this, to take a hard look at verifying some of the things that we were thinking, that really it's more alarming than we really anticipate. And it really focuses back on what do we do with this information now. Based on what we're seeing, is this a type trend that we can expect over the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years? And as people in leadership positions, how do you make decisions reflective of this information that you now have, and what do we do as far as moving forward to meet future demands from roads, water and sewer, land use? I think this is just a very helpful tool for y'all, and I appreciate the hard work of everybody.
But this scenario is not unique to us.
I don't believe so.
State.
I mean, I don't think so. And I'd like to believe one thing that we possess that other areas don't, that is unique, that affects the way we grow, is we have separate school systems. The city of Valdosta and the county schools influence and affect the growth of the county and the city. Now, one thing here to notice is, and I think this is what we're more common with our neighbors in the region throughout the state, at some point, you can only have so much conservation and so much forest land. So at some point, I'd like to believe this is going to stabilize somehow, because you just only have so much land. Now, if you look at what the number was in 2007 for ag, back in 2007, we had about 153,000 acres in ag. Now it's at 66, okay? If you look at how much we had in conservation, we had about 80,000 in conservation in 2007. So at some point, either ag is going to disappear, and we thought we were going to find ags going to residential. That's what's happening. We're going from ag to residential. No, we're going from ag to conservation, to ag to forest. So at some point, I feel like this tax class will kind of stabilize. Maybe then we'll start to see some bigger jumps, because it'll be, we'll have our ag stabilized and that tax class will be, but we haven't seen that yet. I mean, 10,000 acres is a big jump in 5 years to me.
Mark, I think there's significant difference, certainly from what I know of, comparison to Ware County. They do not have, nor have they had for a number of decades, the type of growth that we have had. In the last 18 years, we've gone from 92,000 to
117,000,
14,000. Some of those communities, like Tifton and Ware County's, their growth has almost been flat. Tifton has had a slight increase, I believe, but it's certainly not on the scale that we have had here. And so what we are experiencing, I believe, is much more pronounced here than some of those other communities. I mean, from the standpoint of our regional commission, it's certainly that way.
Yes, I mean, we might have similarities, but it's like what Commissioner Marshall said, as a regional hub, we just have some growth and some factors that other areas don't have, because they come here to shop, they come here to work, and part of that strength is reflected here, and I'm glad for it. But we also have some things going on behind us that don't really tell the true story about how much we've been growing, because you have factors like this behind the scenes that we really believe are tampering what those true numbers are.
Okay. I think also at the same time, seeing that movement from agriculture to conservation to forestry, those sort of things, is also going to put some restrictions on the potential for residential development.
Yes, sir.
As it moves out, because of the because then you will impact that conservation exemption, and it makes that piece of property more expensive to develop, because then you've got to go back and pick up.
Yes, sir.
Like get those exemptions.
When
so
you enter into conservation, you agree, I believe it's a 10-year.
10 years, yeah.
I'm not going to do anything for 10 years, right. Otherwise I'm going to pay a really not very nice fine.
There's a lot of dark green up there that north of the
So that's, I mean, really, I mean, in reality, that's a concern, because, again, you need to kind of take a look at that, and where you already have the conservation at, then you know that development is going to probably not quite get into those areas as much. So it's going to be, again, as we look at how we focus the areas that we're going to have to serve, it's going to have to be in those lighter green areas rather than in those darker areas.
Good job. Thanks.